of the school board agenda for this meeting of June 5th, 2018.
So, pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Alright, we're going to stop the agenda, but we're going to delete the consent agenda out of the meeting because that wasn't supposed to be on the agenda tonight. It won't be on the next agenda. And we're going to delete action item 6 according to this, because that's what we're going to do. And one more thing. We're going to take the administrative appointments and put it under D.
Originally founded in 1954, the Alachua County Teachers Credit Union, as the Alachua County Teachers Credit Union, Florida Credit Union, has served Alachua County for the last 64 years. For over 20 years, we provided scholarships to students seeking a college education in the county to serve. We appreciate the school board for allowing us the opportunity to recognize the 2018 Alachua County recipients. Jasmine Spencer from Virginia Young. Dylan Barnes from Eastside High School. Tyler Melvin from Gainesville High School. His brother Everett is standing in for him tonight. And two others that couldn't be here tonight, Garrett Ferguson and Eve Lampa from Newport High School. Florida Credit Union is happy to award these hardworking scholars and wishes them much success in their future endeavors. Thank you.
Hi, the next John Fitzpatrick is here and Sheila Payne with him. And they're going to bring some people's presenters with these poetry contest winners. This was on May the 5th, right? And, you know, I was there, Mrs. Roy was there, and Dr. McNeely. I think, you know, I'm speaking out loud, and so it's all the fault of the patients. It was really a process that was worth doing. And I wish I could write poems, but these kids, they write poems. It was just encouraging. What they said, I don't know how long it takes to get a couple hours. It was really just the whole time. It wasn't like it was long. It was like Jerry Moore. So if you could talk about how John fits back to his curriculum, chair, gospel, the board, Stephen Jay Clark. Thanks for making time on your agenda today to celebrate Alachua County poets. We have, two poets here tonight who won awards at the 9th Annual Peace Poetry Contest hosted by the Unisville Chapter of the Veterans for Peace. And here tonight representing the Veterans for Peace with Stephen Jay.
Okay, I was hoping y'all could see the poets when they read the poems. It's just very moving. But, so thank you, Mr. Fitzpatrick and Mrs. Clark, for inviting us. And thanks to the school board members who always come. So, though this contest holds no formal position on the current state of world affairs, we still want to honor the ideal of peace and social justice through the perspectives of young people. We'd like to thank all the student poets who wrote poems and were interested in expressing their ideas about peace and social justice. We thank all the teachers, schools, and parents who encouraged their students to participate. The poems this year were just so powerful. I think it had a lot to do with, there were a lot of the older students wrote about school safety. And many teachers told us that their students really get into talking about peace and social justice when they're writing the poems. So the poems, we have 350 poems submitted. The judges, community judges, spent a week going through them. They each had copies of every poem because they had such a hard time making up their mind. They ended up choosing 46 winning poems. And the Sierra Club also is showcasing environmental poems in their online newsletter every month with the permission of the poets. So we'd like to hear the poets reading their poems at the Peace Reception. You can go to the Veterans for Peace website, and also there's photos, and also the Peace Poetry book is posted online. This was the fourth year that Veterans for Peace also gave out four $750 peace scholarships to provide financial aid to students who are planning careers in pursuit of a more equitable, peaceful, and just world. The winners were again extraordinary. So if y'all can help us get seniors paid to this apply next year, to submit applications, that'd be great. We also presented seven teachers who have had their students participating every year with gift cards to the school supply store. And I was asked to say just a little bit about what Veterans for Peace does. I'm sure most of you know our best known venture is the Memorial Mile Display on Northwest 8th Avenue. This year, we would have been placing 6,923 tombstones to honor those service members killed in Iraq and Afghanistan. It's a solemn occasion to take care of the tombstones and escort loved ones who come to pay respect. Most of the members of Veterans for Peace in Alachua County were Vietnam veterans, but we also have younger members from recent wars. We co-host the International Peace Day locally. We work to help save the VA from privatization. We promote alternatives to military through our listening guides and other literature which shows both sides of military service. We're also all very involved in the community with donations of time and money. We pay for this with our Winter Solstice concert. Again, you can see photos of everything we do on our website, Veterans for Peace Gainesville. And the Peace Poetry book, we only printed 200 of them. We had 200 people show up. They did bring a few that I grabbed. But you can see all the winning poems on the Veterans for Peace website. And these kids, it was really powerful. It was just incredible to be there and give them a very moving.
Thank you, Steve, and the Veterans for Peace for their long-time commitment to creative writing and to the students of Alachua County. Our first poet today is a Mari artist from Fort Clark Middle School. She's here with her family and her assistant principal, Ms. Lee, and her teacher is Matt from Amari. Could you guys just give a microphone? So you can hear these calls, they're really cool.
My phone is called a broken people. A broken people unable to find the ability to find hope. A broken people able themselves to find hope. A broken people acting as if they were satisfied and can't be ready to count on them. A broken people, but they will what they feel around. Let the weak sound of song. Let the strong get courage, let the poor sound. A broken people, no matter how broken we are, they will rise in the world.
Next we have Kate Cavernum from Buholz High School. Her principal is Mr. Kimberg and her teacher is Ms. Bramlett.
Not one more. Does Haverly break the silence with our demands and thought of its clean tears? Our simple request is to lessen gun violence and not witness bullets pierce our peers. They say we're reacting off the feeling, thinking with the heart, not head. But just because it's not their lives, those are feelings, doesn't mean the kids aren't dead. It shouldn't be hard to connect the dots. Assault rifles can be purchased besides sold to the store. This can't be fixed with prayers and thoughts. We need to ban the weapons of war. They only see the number, not each life. Each scholar, athlete, daughter, and son. It would have been harder with a knife. And yet we're told to respect the laws for gun. I have family over in Norway. They asked if I was scared to get shot. It was 3 years ago and I said, no way, I'm safe in my country, so I thought. Have you heard about Lori, whose daughter is dead? She clothes herself and lost his body spray, and lies covered in blankets to his bed, and so far has tried 10 pounds away. I'll show you logic and I'll pick out my tissue. They think mental illness would be our biggest fear. Well, mental illness is a global issue. These mass shootings happen uniquely here. In the middle of class, an alarm sounding and the jiggling of the knob to the door leaves everyone's heart pounding. Wanting change isn't something we'll apologize for. To speakers remain silent, that's your choice, but it's not the time for self-doubt. Your opinions are valid, so use your voice, and soon we'll all look back. Thank you.
Thank you to these cohorts, the teachers and principals who support creative writing and for the various pieces that we can set in. Thank you for having us.
Do we have the mothers stand up or something like that?
Our first administrative appointment this evening will be for our district chief of school security, Mr. Casey Hamilton. Unfortunately, Mr. Hamilton cannot join us this evening. His mother passed away yesterday evening, and so he's not able to join us tonight. I want to extend his well wishes and wanted to extend his excitement and that he's ready to get started working for the children of Alachua County. Casey Hamilton graduated from Connecticut College in 1992 with his associate's high degree in criminal justice technology. And earned his law enforcement certification from the Commission on Criminal Justice Standards and Training in 1994. He began his career in law enforcement in 1994 as a patrol officer for Angel Police Department, and then in 1997 became a reserve deputy for Alachua County Sheriff's Office. In 1999, he became a full-time sheriff's deputy where he served in many capacities. Throughout his career in the Sheriff's Department, he's been assigned court security patrol deputy, and has also served as a detective on the Child Sexual Predator Task Force. And he's also served as a school resource officer in many of our schools at all levels. Mr. Hamilton has also led special units within the Sheriff's Department, such as the negotiations response team. He's a criminal justice standards and training instructor, immediate response rifle team, and the crisis and intervention stress management. I recommend that the school board appoint Mr. Casey Hamilton as district chief of CPS security effective June 19, 2018.
Mm-hmm. whatever it says in the Bible. Just say hi.
Alright, so now we'll begin our principal appointments. My first appointment this evening is for the principal of Newbury High School, Mr. James Zebbert. Mr. Zebbert is a perfect example of a homegrown educator, having graduated from Newbury High School in 1986. After graduating from Newbury High, he attended Bethel College, graduating in 1990 with a degree in health, recreation, and physical education. In 2007, he received his master's degree in educational leadership from Nova Southeastern University. In 1992, Mr. Zebbert was appointed to his first teaching position at Westwood Middle School as a physical education teacher. And after 2 years, he transferred to Littlewood Elementary to become a behavior resource teacher, where he served for 13 years. In 2007, he became the assistant principal at Eastside High School, and then in 2016, he returned to his alma mater as assistant principal of Newbury High School. I recommend that Mr. James Zebbert be appointed as the principal of Newbury High School effective July 1st, 2018.
I often wonder if you know what would be very wicked with Mr. Shepherd when that came out of the district. You know that scares me. I used to have a post against this school. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm inviting in favor of Mr. Shepherd as a principal in the very high school.
Our greetings to this great board and our distinguished superintendent, Ms. Clark. I'm super excited to be chosen as a Newbury High School principal. Most people work a lifetime and never get the opportunity to have their dream job. I graduated from here in 1986, and I tell you, this is my dream job. There was a man that he was walking along in a farm one day, and he looked to the right and he said, "Wow, I see a turtle sitting on a pole." So he asked the turtle, "Why are you sitting on the pole?" The turtle said to him, "I didn't get here by myself. I didn't get here by myself as well, and I do want to thank some people. First, I want to thank Jeff Carbonell, who gave me the opportunity to get in administrative school and be the assistant principal at Eastside High School. I also want to thank Mr. Kevin Purvis, who really just took me and worked with me and showed me things that I did not know, and he just really worked with me. So if I make any mistakes, you blame Kevin Purvis. And also, it's a host of people here, and you get in the calling names, and I tell you, I don't want to start calling names. I may miss someone, but I do have to mention a couple of people, and I really thank everyone for you. It's okay with the board. If you didn't support me, can you stand up, please? This will give all of you a huge hug and thank you so much. But I do want to mention a special lady to me, and that's my mother. That's over her in the wheelchair there that's looking so beautiful tonight. She has had the chance to see her son the last few weeks get elevated into a minister and now be the principal of Newbury High School. I tell you, if you cut off the lights tonight, it'd still be lighting here the way she's been. Also, my sister, who takes wonderful care of her, my son is there, my brother is there as well, my special friend, I said I will go get into that. My special friend, Tyler, and her sister, Mrs. Purvis as well. And I tell you, I don't want to miss anyone, but I'm telling you this, you all made the right.
How are you, Mr. Clark?
Well, I don't know if I can talk about it. And for the next
don't worry, you don't have to talk that, okay? next up, we'll speak the word, my recommendation for the principal of Wiles Elementary School is Ms. Catherine Munn. Munn graduated with a bachelor's degree in elementary education with a specialization in early childhood. She went on to earn her master's degree in educational leadership in 2002 from Nova Southeastern University. She began her teaching career in 1989 in Dade County, where she was finalist for Rookie Teacher of the Year. She began her career in Alachua County as a fifth grade teacher at Duval Elementary in 1992, and then in 1995 she moved to Waldo Elementary, and then she referred to Newbury Elementary School, where she remained until 2005. She taught fifth grade and served as the BRT and the CRT at that school. And in 1999, she was named Teacher of the Year for Newbury Elementary. In 2005, she was promoted to be the assistant principal at Fort Clark Middle School. And in 2007, she was named principal of Littlewood Elementary School, where she served for 5 years. Mrs. Munn was then appointed to the principalship at Oakey Middle School in 2013, where she has also served. I recommend Ms. Catherine Munn be appointed as the principal of Wiles Elementary School effective July 1st, 2018.
I do want to introduce my family. My husband's here with me, my two children, Thomas and Katrina, and my two grandchildren, which I'm not sure where my granddaughter is.
Did you just name her a stranger?
yeah, I do want to thank you for this opportunity. I know it's going to be a lot of hard work, but it'll be worth it. Thank you.
Thank you. My family is over there.
Mr. Armstrong graduated from Florida State University in 2000 with a Bachelor's of Science degree in Social Studies Education and a minor in Business. He received his Master's degree in Educational Leadership from St. Leo University in 2012. Mr. Armstrong began his teaching career in 2000 at Taylor County High School teaching 9th grade American History and Reading and remained a teacher there until 2007. He then transferred to Alachua County, teaching first at Fort Clark and then transferring to Louisville High School. He was promoted to assistant principal of Oakey Middle School in 2012. In 2016, Mr. Armstrong was appointed as principal at Glen Springs Elementary, where he has served for the last 2 years. I recommend Mr. Kelly Armstrong as the principal of Oakey Middle School effective July 1st, 2018.
Any discussion? My name is Mr. Armstrong, as the principal of Oakview. Opposed, like so. I think it's me. Mr. Armstrong.
But at the same time,
a very young business facility with you. That's where I started that years ago, and I couldn't be happier. I will miss my family there at Palm Springs. It's a special place, but I'm really excited. So thank you.
To
returned to the Cathedral in 1999, where she returned to foster as a classroom teacher, where she taught for 9 years before taking on the role of reading coach and principal facilitator in 2008. In 2010, she became a curriculum research teacher principal intern at Foster, where she served for 5 years. She was named assistant principal at Metcalf in June of 2015 and was then promoted to principal in July of 2016. I recommend that Elena Mayo be appointed as principal of Norton Elementary School effective July 1st, 2018.
Mrs. Griffith, second by Mrs. Floyd. Any discussion? Mrs. Mayerman, you taught Miramar. My wife grew up in Miramar. So, anyway, come on up and meet me. Hi, everybody in favor of Mrs. Mayo?
Aye.
Grateful to Norton?
Aye.
Everybody, do you have a question? Okay. Fine. Everybody opposed? One side? No? Okay, you may. Mr. Bell? Welcome.
Just first, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you very much to Sarah and children at Norton Elementary. I'm a firm believer that every time we leave a place, we take with us a little bit more knowledge. I had lots of things that I learned from Stephen Foster the first time I was there, many things that I learned from Miramar. And then again at Foster, and when I was at Foster, I always felt that it was home. I went to Metcalf with Mr. Kuhn and realized that home is really where the children are, and that my heart really belongs to the kids. I truly love the children at Metcalf Elementary. Love my staff at Metcalf Elementary, and I'm going to miss them greatly. I feel that I'm a better principal because I got to work with those children and those teachers, and I am so excited to move to Norton and to learn more, because I feel like this is a journey, and everything we do is about learning. So I just want to thank you for the opportunity to move to Norton and continue my journey as So my family was not able to be here tonight, but I'm also a firm believer in teamwork, and I'll say my right hand for the past 2 years is here, and I'm going to miss her greatly. Totally right. Thank you. Next, for Principal Metcalf Elementary, Ms. Claire Roll. Ms. Roll earned her Bachelor's of Science degree in Telecommunications in 1987 from the University of Florida. She received her Master's in Accessible Student Education in 2009 from the University of Florida, and then a Specialist degree in Educational Leadership in 2015 from Florida State University. She began her teaching career in 2000 at Duval Elementary, where she taught kindergarten, fourth grade, and was also a reading coach, set up coach, mentor coach, and SEL facilitator. In 2009, she engaged the district to serve as a literacy coach. In 2010, Ms. Roll began her position as a school improvement specialist and regional reading coordinator for the Office of Differentiated Accountability with the Florida Department of Education. In 2014, she returned to Alachua County as the curriculum resource teacher at Williams Elementary and was promoted to assistant principal in 2015 at Williams Elementary. And she was named principal at Williams in 2016, where she served for the past 2 years. I recommend Ms. Floyd Roll as the principal of Metcalf Elementary School effective July 1st,
2018. Everybody in favor of Mr. Roll as principal at Metcalf Elementary School? Right? So we have a good one. So we have
Superintendent Clark, Chair Paulson, board members, and Mrs. Jones, I appreciate your confidence in me to lead Metcalf Elementary. I ask for your continued support as I work to increase student achievement at Metcalf and Elementary. I have with me tonight my husband, Cecil Rowe, to support me, and I also have a variety of my colleagues. I just want to thank you again. I will do everything I can to increase student achievement in the building. Thank you.
Ms. Anyanis Stokes. Ms. Stokes is not with us this evening. She and her daughter have a wonderful opportunity in Pensacola. They're seeing previously scheduled, and she does send her well wishes and her excitement, and is ready to start as well. But I still wanted to read her bio for you this evening. Ms. Stokes is teacher bachelor's of arts and green communications from the University of North Florida, and master's degree in educational leadership from Lewis University. She began her Alachua County teaching career in 1999 as a language arts teacher at Lincoln Middle School. She then moved to Orlando, where she spent the next 5 years teaching, as well as serving as an adjunct professor at Valencia Community College. Ms. Stokes returned to Alachua County in 2004, where she taught reading and language arts at Howard Bishop Middle School. She was then named Dean of Students in 2006, and then as assistant principal and magnet program coordinator in 2012. In 2017, she was appointed as assistant principal for curriculum at Stanford High School. I recommend that Ms. Anyanis Stokes be appointed as principal of Williams Elementary School, effective July 1st, 2018.
Everybody in favor, say aye. Everybody opposed, say aye. Right now, we're going to take a 3-minute break so people can read, whoever wants to read, can read, and we'll read school next. But it's this point. Bring this meeting back to order. We're now at board member superintendent analysis. How about you, Mr. Superintendent? Let's look around the order. Is that better? Okay. All right, Mr. Dr. McNeil, you're
thank you, Mr. Chair. Congratulations to all of the Alachua County student graduates. Each month, elementary, middle school, and high school. And we probably have some pre-teens as well. So congratulations to all of you, and may all of your dreams and goals come true. I want to now move forward to thank Issa Carter, her team, for the wonderful invitation to participate with the Certified Instructional Coaching Program. Each year we had this, and the reception that we do, and to award the certificates for the members of the cohort, that this is extremely important. This program is in conjunction with the Lassinger Center of Learning in the College of Education at the University of Florida. And I must say that each year that I've attended, I learn more and more from the cohort. I understand from Ms. Carter that next year it won't just be the presentations from each member of the cohort, but they'll actually put it in a field forward. So you don't want to miss that opportunity for the 18-19 school year. So thank you again, Ms. Carter, and her team. At this point, I'd like to award or present this beautiful award to Ms. Clark, our superintendent. It is presented from the students, staff, community, and everyone in Harbaugh. And it was such a wonderful event, the FFA. I certainly had a good time. A good time learning from the students and also good food. That's always a must. So it says presented to the school board of Alachua County for your support of the Hawthorne FFA 2018. And it's a wonderful plaque with the students and officers of the Hawthorne FFA. So, and then I'd like to also recognize, maybe I should say, put out a plea. You know, we are always asking for volunteers, but I'm especially asking for volunteers for this group. This group is called emissary. And you might be asking, what is the parent emissary all about? Well, they're volunteers who come to help parents engage more with their child's school, and it sort of empowers the parents to do the work that we are all wanting to support them in. And so if you would be willing to join this group, it is again called the Parent Emissary. And it was established through the conjunction with the City of Gainesville, and we're so happy that we have this program in place. We want our parents to do all they can from the home side while we are doing from the school side. This program strengthens parents' knowledge of how to engage with their child's school. It helps with attendance. It helps with behavior. And it helps with academic performance. Mrs. Hazel Gore is the leader of this program, the Parent Emissary, and I promised her that I would put out a special plea tonight. We do need volunteers in various things in our school district, but I really want people to consider joining the Parent Emissary. And if you need any further information, I'm sure you can call the district office. Mrs. Chair, that's it.
Oh, that's very good.
The chess challenge this year was at Williams Elementary. It's the 20th year that they've done the chess challenge, and I was able to go and witness the third graders and the first graders playing each other. It was really cool. And each kid gets their own chess set to take home. And thank you to Eastside this year. They have a project day, so they sent a whole bunch of kids from Eastside to play chess also. And they took it easy on the elementary school kids. But anyway, that's always the fun time. And I also went to the Lost in Art show. It was in the afternoon, but I took a preview. And it was spectacular. The kids loved them. But all of the students did their art. So it's not just the AP kids that get to display their stuff. And it was really a unique art show. And you got to learn about the kids this time, the way that they presented everything. So I just want to put a plug in that you get a chance next year to go to that. And then again, all the graduations, like Dr. McNeely said, it's really cool to see the culmination of all the work that you come to an end. Well, an end for us, for the beginning for the kids, and how each one is different. That's always amazing, too. And if we ever can figure out how to get Hawthorne on its own day, like this year, Lofton was on its own day, so I was able to do more. And anyway, so I'm going to plug in for that. Congratulations
to
all the hard work the students and teachers
have
done.
Mr. Rowan?
Thank you, Dr. Wilson. Also, I'm always impressed by the congratulations to everybody. I mean, the principals do a fantastic job, and they're always very inspiring. And I know a lot of us went to several of the graduations. Always an enjoyable event. I wanted to mention the Civics Challenge, which was operated by, or I guess instituted by, the League of Women Voters. This pitted Hawthorne students against Lincoln Middle School students, Hawthorne Middle School against Lincoln Middle School. And they were adorable. They really studied their civics and their history, and they knew Supreme Court cases, and it was very impressive. The questions were very hard. There were a bunch of lawyers sitting out there that couldn't answer the questions. So, I was impressed with the kids, impressed with the event. I thought it was just very interesting to have kids cognizant of these things, learning about these things. So that was fun. And also, mentioned the Elementary Honor Choir, which many of us went to, which was spectacular.
these kids practice together all day, and then they perform that night. And I brought my husband, who was so impressed. I knew he would love it if he did. So, anyway, that was a great success too. That's it. Thank you so much.
I remember when my oldest daughter started school, Steve Crawford,
I've been in this district for a long time. Grandchildren are just as important as the children. But what I missed is, for good reason, saving the other students here between we can't do all settlements, there's one to choose for. I'm sorry, Mr. Hawthorne. I just want to ask for the GHS. My number of things I've considered my camera. I was very close to the task force before I was on the school board. She was vice president when I was president. She is a jewel. She is one of the jewels of this school. People don't know the things that she does. When she does something, it's for the employees and it's for the schools. She has done things that go unnoticed and mistakes. I want people to understand we have lost considered jewels. One of the jewels of this school district, and she's going to be great to this. I know the things she's doing for this school. So, helping with the 1 million initiative to make sure we don't get too much money or we just can't afford to do it. So, having this school has been wonderful. I just want to say, Karen, if you're watching this, you will be this way. So, it's for me. I'm going to be in support.
Yes, sir. I will be yielding my time to our student representative, Alexandria. She had a few words. But I did want to recognize Alexandria. She did graduate from Buchholz High School last weekend. This will be her final meeting with us as our student representative. She's blazed the trail for future representatives and actually helped our district staff write the policy as to how the new representatives would be selected each year. So, this is something new for us, but I believe that you've represented the students of this district as well, Alexandria, and we appreciate what you've done and how you helped us out. So, yielding the rest of my time to you.
I just wanted to say thank you so much for giving me a chance to represent the students on the school board. I know that you probably didn't know who I was until I sent you an email and said, would it be possible to make this happen? And so I just want to say thank you so much to Dr. McNeely for helping me to get started with the process and helping me to create the position.
Now we'll go to citizens' input. We have 15 minutes for first citizens' input total. Everyone will get 3 minutes to talk. Please don't go over that. First person I have is Judith Hastings from the field.
Members, Chief Olson, community members. I want to especially thank Superintendent Clark for her leadership this first year, considering all the unexpected exceptions from weather, school closings, to the logistics of housing residents, managing flu season, and providing safety protocols and student marches. The board and the community as myself, I appreciate your leadership in keeping our children safe and our community safe. Since it is school safety month, I also want to thank Ms. Tidwell. I saw her at the beginning of the school board meeting, but she's the director of ESC services, also the district nurses and the Alachua County Health advisory members for revising the school health services handbook. It's a very well-compiled handbook and informs the community of the services and procedures provided by school nurses and staff as assigned to those students. So the district faces health screenings, referrals, and hearing, vision, and health concerns are available to our community. As I was reviewing page 47 of the health services guide, I did not see any mention of vape devices under stimulants. I think it's something that should be mentioned. The tobacco industry has launched a campaign to target Generation Z, and
so-called social media. And they have made their products very attractive to students, especially the Juul, and which looks like a university device. And the pods come in from a variety of colors and flavors. So I think this is something faculty and community members should be aware of. Since these companies, especially the Juul, have not really known the side effects of these products for adults, much less younger children. I do appreciate the fact that these cigarettes and the vapor pens were mentioned in the revised 2018-2019 Code of Student Conduct Handbook on page 10 under tobacco products. The revision of the handbook represents the changing times and school safety, the responsibilities all members have in keeping a safe campus, and the expectation the community has of a school board. Part of feeling safe and knowing you feel accepted and welcome is, just being self-happy, so we feel welcome. So, board members, please continue your efforts to adhere to the policies, especially policy 2260, non-discrimination and access to equal educational opportunities, and policy 16.01, which is discrimination based on disability, as stated on page 2 of the Student Code of Conduct Handbook. Thank you.
Hi, Ms. Heather Sturgeon, Hawthorne High. Please look for the advocating session on the high school after as long as I can remember. Nobody has
been. Thank you for having us. And, and I really mostly here tonight is on a positive note. You know, we don't know what our outcome is. I mean, we know in our hearts for the work that has been done from the community, the teachers, the parents, and especially, students have just gone all in and, just worked their tails off. So we're really excited. But before that, before we even get the results, I wanted to come up here and personally thank you, the school board, Superintendent Clark, just for going to bat for us every time we had to deal with the state. I want to thank Conlin from Alachua County, PTA, and that whole group, just in the whole county, that just said, we're going to do everything we can, and everybody got behind Hawthorne, and it felt so good to see, to just continue to be in awe at the outpouring of love and support from, the county, and even people all over the world. Social media is amazing. We needed extra copy paper. We had a whole storage room full of copy paper that was sent by Amazon or whoever, because somebody that was an alumni from Hawthorne, we might be in the military or just moved across from Europe, they ordered paper. Just different things along that. That was just amazing. A huge impact was made, and we will continue to have our journey. And I urge the district continue to be involved, continue to be hands-on, continue to go out there. But there's amazing things happening in Hawthorne. And I always use build it and they will come. Because as a perfect example, we were at the Washington County Youth Fair. We were the largest group there, and that was our first year back in over a decade. And we had a lot of first place, my daughter first place, four first place pages out of 12. So it was just amazing to see huge accomplishment. And our middle school civics, they won the first place. So Hawthorne's doing huge things. We just need to give them a chance. I appreciate y'all going all in for Hawthorne. I'm excited to see what the elementary school and the question of the teams. They've got over 400 kids there. Whenever my daughter was there, she's 12th grade now, only 200. We did welcome the Waldo School with open arms, and we are all one big family. But we cannot be that Waldo School. We need to continue to thrive in Hawthorne, and it's neat to see that 65% of our scores are 3% or higher and state average was 57%. So, and 16% of the elementary, and these are the elementary scores, were 5, and 39% were 4. So we have some excellent achieving kids, you know, and I just, you know, all these kids were coming up to the Boston Middle High School. So we got to build it. We've got to continue to partner together, and you know, any feedback would be great. And I know I'm running out of time, but just wanted to remind you, you know, we have 165 kids coming into Gainesville that could be in Hawthorne, and we have over 120 kids in a lot of our neighboring counties where that could be 13 teaching units that we could bring back to Hawthorne and we just invest. And so I want to thank you for the arts and the music that really enhances back into Hawthorne. So I look forward to working with all of you.
Continue to keep Hawthorne strong and going
all in. So, thank you. Thank you so much. Anybody else? Anybody else? Okay. My name is Phil Fritz. Members coming out today. And I'm thank you to former Coach Carlson and my former pronouncement teacher, Main P. Carlson, class during the summer when you taught at the Gainesville High School Function of Beyond the Main P. Carlson class. So,
what do
you think?
You were?
Yes, I was just a massive high school always there, my first. Now, I would like to speak on the as far as I'm concerned, many members who live, work in Gainesville, Florida, black schools, in regard to the University of Florida School of Engineering is in East Gainesville. It's a public university. Great research. So I'm asking this school board to reach out to the University of Florida and to see if this resource can be utilized to participate in a science and math magnet school, like take, for example, a school ball, elementary, or Raleigh's elementary. Or it's a Harry. I don't think that school is being used now. Math and science helps teach students how to think more critically, to make good decisions, or good choices, productive choices, etc., etc. And there's another benefit to this as well. For example, Atlanta, Georgia, this college by the name of Georgia Tech. That's what I forced them to attend as they graduate from the Southland dual enrollment program, grade 100 to 4.2. I mean, chemical, slash, molecular chemical engineer, and probably another job with DuPont, or Canadian, or Sparger, or Merck, for this sort of thing. So, these corporations, they assist the, by donating money to the local school districts in Atlanta, which benefits them or behooves them, because they're going to meet the next young, talented scientists, engineers, chemical engineers, etc., etc. And my question is to the school board, why don't we have a science slash math magnet school in East Gainesville? I think it's been long overdue. It's something that we need to think about. I know there's one on Stephen Foster, which is West Gainesville, if I'm mistaken. I don't understand why. Yes. So, I think it will be a great idea. We see where the world is going in regards to industry, technology. This goes on. So, that's my part of it.
Thank you very much. Anybody else? So let's go to the consent agenda, Mrs. Clark.
Thank you, Dr. Paulson. I recommend that the school board approve the consent agenda as described in items 1 through 19. However, the meeting number 18.
Motion by Mr. Clark, Mr. Hyatt, and Mr. Hyatt. And second by Mr. Clark. Any discussion? Aye. All in favor of the consent agenda as presented, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Action item 1, Mrs. Clark.
The superintendent recommends that the school board approve the proposed amendments to the 2018-19 Code of Student Conduct for Elementary and Secondary, the amendments to the 2018-2019 Student Progression Plan, and proposed adoption, amendment, and repeal to various policies set forth in the attached spending list for emphasis. Schedule a public hearing on June 19, 2019, at 6:30 p.m.
Okay. Anybody make a motion?
Second.
Motion by Ms. Griffin, second by Mrs. Doyle. Any discussion on this item? Okay. All in favor of the Code of Student Conduct for Elementary and Secondary and Amendments to Student Progression Plan? Say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed? The next item? Okay, that's the one I missed. Aye. Action item 3, Mr. White. Mr. White. Mr. Tower. I don't know where you're going to see Mr. White. I
don't know where you're going to see Mr. White. Bid was received on the construction of the Inmost Elementary School parking complex phase 2 for May 17, 2018. The superintendent recommends that the school board accept the low base bid and award the contract for construction total $168,862 to John Hill Construction Company. The placement of the project will be for the 45 respective calendar day from the date indicated in the motion.
All right, do we have a motion to approve the bid award for project 875? Yes, we have a second by Mr. Board. I feel like I'm going to change the order. I'm going to the first round. And any discussion? Anybody in favor of the bid award? Say aye.
Aye.
Vote for your
side. Mr. Hall. Dr. Hall, the board members. Well, first of all, Charles Maxwell, Bulwer Springs. And you're just going to deny Bulwer Springs charge school serve students for age K through 5 and has operated for 10 years, which meant 2013. The current charter contract 2013 to 2018 expires on June 30th of this year. The proposed first renewal charter contract sets forth the terms and conditions for operation of the school and follows a state template with a term of 5 years, July 1, 2018 to June 30th, 2023. The superintendent recommends the school board approve the first renewal charter contract with Bulwer Springs Charter School 2018-2023 as presented. Just like to add to it, this item will appear in the office in case you have any presentation as it pertains to the director of the school.
Second by Mrs. Roy. Any discussion? Right. Anybody in favor of the Bulwer Springs first renewal charter contract? Opposed? Right. Sorry, I'm kidding.
Thank you, board members. Yes, we have an amendment to the Resilience Charter Schools contract. Due to enrollment and staffing issues, Resilience Charter our school is determined that it will not be able to serve high school students adequately to ensure that all high school students graduate with the classes met. Accordingly, they are requesting that the charter amendment for the district be modified to cover only grades 6 through 8. In addition, there was a scrimmage error when the agreement was executed, which resulted in resilience being described as a public employee rather than product. Maybe you have questions about that, and Miss Hill is in the office, she's the director of the school. I think she can answer any questions you may have to that, although she's already explained that this was an error that was apparently in the original contract that was caught the second time around, and their attorney has advised them that they are in a better position where they can come avoid contracts if they are a private rather than a public. So if you want to add something to that, you may well want to do that.
Good evening, Mr. Liberal. I apologize for my casual retiree school cleaning up today, so that was not dirty. Essentially, we wanted to offer our employees at will contracts and our attorney advice that we needed to be operating as a private employer to do so, and we realized that somehow in the contract, our charter application had requested that we operate as a private employer, but the contract was issued with us being listed as a public employer. I think it's sort of a standard language. Mr. Moore suggested that that may have just been an oversight. I was not a member of the founding board of the school at that time, so I can speak to what actually happened, but it appears from Mr. Moore's review of the records that.
It's not really well established in the charter school world. My view is that public employers are usually a complete open a charter school and some sort of larger nonprofit that might just come up as a simple public employer. Most of our boards are I do think in looking at this, as Mr. Moore said, this is kind of the standard language to present a template that was there probably.
No, it's my mistake, because their application specifically said private.
Well, what I'm trying to do is what the client will.
So I was a human resources manager before I came to Resilience, and we were an adult private employer, and it meant that we offer a year-long contract for our teachers with a start and end date and an annual salary, but the at-will employment arrangement does state that with notice for any reason the teacher could leave if they wanted to, and also that we could terminate if we needed to do it in the school year, but I believe that's different from a public employer. Public school.
That was different. Public school board school as a public employer. I honestly do not know if it applies to charter school classified as
private.
It's not just a
number. Yeah. That's what contingent.
Okay, so if they're bargaining in the members, they have a collective bargaining right. Teachers, they have just cause and all the
other.
I was just confused as to why a public charter school is a private employer.
It is a very confusing element of the law, as I understand it as well, and in my attempting to learn about all of it, I think it is one of the more confusing aspects of charter school law, and it is one of the things that continues to be researched and developed, and everyone's coming to more understanding around that. How that does seem to be one of the places that operates differently is that the nature of the employee-employer relationship within a charter school, as far as I know, it was offered to us, and, of course, supposed to be offered to us in the council, charters have the option to operate as a private employer, which, as far as I know, simply governs the nature of the relationship between the employee and the employer. But still, a public charter school can not, we are a public school open to any student in Alachua County and not surrounding counties.
I just wondered if that's one of these conscious decisions on the part of not you, but the charter school industry to keep their reference somewhat inaccessible to the public accessibility.
That's a problem. I see what you're saying. My understanding is that we still are entirely, required to comply with all public records, requests in any way other than the confidential and personnel records are protected.
I just know that's a problem to settle with.
Oh, sure. I don't understand how to be a consumer.
Well, first, I'm not sure if you're going to have a
teacher, a retired law enforcement officer who wanted to go into education because he wanted to make a difference in young people's lives and hopefully keep them out of the criminal justice system where he had been seen. He found that teaching was a lot harder than he thought and I coached him, and I coached him, and I gave him positive feedback, and I watched him teach, and I actually thought he was a great teacher. And halfway in the school year, he just really wanted to go. He just really wanted to go. And I felt like I had done everything within my power to try to boost him up and tell him that he just needed to make it through that first year and just see it on the other side. He would see what a difference he had made, and that he was doing a great job. But he was at a stress level that he really was having a hard time managing in his life. And so I wanted to free him. So in my consultation with my attorney around just to make sure I was doing everything I needed to do, that's what just came up. It wasn't the other way around. It was me saying, and my attorney saying to me, well, are you operating as a private employer? And I said, well, I guess I need to go check my contract. And that's where I found in my contract. Actually, it says we're public. But I always thought we were operating as a private employer. Talked about it and looked at the details. So that's actually how it came up. It was actually because he was wanted to.
First of all, we have
other public entity is provided for by law. As such, the charter school may be either private or the public as well. So it really is most of our, if not all of our charter schools, are run by a private, not-for-profit organization. But there are charter schools that are run by teachers. I'm not saying run by a town, but there could be other public entities that can open a charter school too.
And the other piece of that was that the second phase was, I told him, I give you my blessing, I can see that you know, this has been the shift you need to make. But then he also wanted me to wait. He gave me notice in, November, he wanted me to wait until he had a secured another position before I, he wanted me to keep working until he had another job lined up and then go. And I explained how complicated it was for me to find a teacher, was the hiring process. Someone who would be willing to wait until some indeterminate time for him to leave, or and it's going to be testing season, it's very complicated. So then I was in a position where I was consulting with my attorney, am I going to have to terminate? How is this going to work? Because we're in kind of a strange transitional time now. So in those conversations, that's how this came up.
Mr. Chair, I don't know how much that way, but a public employer can also be looking at how I ask. But I would suggest I ask you to accept most of our non-profit companies.
We have a simple IRA plan.
Why are we
doing? I know all your questions are very reasonable.
Anybody else have any questions? All right. Anybody in favor of this way of project? Board member superintendent request, gentlemen. Actually,
STEM programs. I know that GRU is interested in working with us, but we do not have what I think this year was referred to as but that is not an East Side school. At least I would consider it an East Side school. And I think he mentioned that in his conversation with us. And then when you look at the program over at Williams, that is not considered American Side school. It's a gifted program, but it's not.
Often we have an experience what we do with UFO. I'm not saying that, I just think that we need to be better informed our parents of what we do offer so that we can yes. So anyway, that's what I want. Just want to remind everyone that there's different checks and evaluations in Brazil, this Friday. I didn't remember the day exactly.
This is somewhat of a soft deadline. We definitely need to have the evaluations back tabulated for July 1st, the sort of next contract year for the superintendent. So the sooner you can get them to me, the better. Again, sometime next week as opposed to this Friday, that's going to be okay. The question has been raised if there's aspects of the evaluation that we simply don't have the data on yet, and we knew that back when we adopted these goals, but that was going to be sort of an ongoing issue since the state DOE doesn't get us all the data back. We're just going to have to roll that on from year to year after this question. But there are strategies that the superintendent outlined that school is going to use to try to achieve some of those goals, and we do have information about which of those strategies have been implemented, so that can help the board with the evaluation process.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to remind the public that we have a workshop coming up, which will involve our sales tax initiative. And I certainly expect to see you there at Springfield Baptist Church beginning at 9 a.m. Yes. Beginning at 9 a.m. I understand you must like to us now, but let's put that later in the day.
I won't be here in the next meeting, and I won't be here for that forum. I'm going to Idaho for a wedding of one of my kids, and so I will be out of town for that. I just want to come back to show you the next meeting, and I'm sorry I'm going to miss that, but if we have a moment, it would be nice to help you with your trip. Thank you.
coming up, we're going to be streamlining our discussion about this.
Currently, the workshop schools are open on Tuesday. This is primarily our careers and education programs and for serving prior to our next school meetings. So, our students will be here for the year.
All the students are going to be here for the year. I don't know. If nobody else wants something else, just leave them with something.